Hey there, and welcome back to the Total Potential Podcast. I'm Cole, and I'm joined by a fellow dietitian today, which makes me so happy. Karina Nava, who owns her own business, Karina Nava Nutrition, she's here with me, and we are going to have a fun conversation because I think Karina and I share a lot of similar beliefs around nutrition. So, welcome, and thank you for joining us, Karina.
Yeah, thanks, Cole. It's really awesome to be part of this podcast.
Yeah, I'm so excited to have you here. I like get real geeked out when I get to talk to other dietitians because ever since I've, left like a very specific nutrition space, it's just not as part of my daily experience as I'm used to. So once I do get a chance to circle back like into that nutrition focus, it just kind of like, I don't know, rings all the old bells and whatnot. Yeah. So it's exciting. Yeah.
Yeah, I know, that's great.
Wonderful. Okay, so before we dive into some of like the really exciting and important, ideas and things that we share around nutrition and, things that you help support people with, I'm interested to know just like background wise, what were kind of the things that led you up to choosing even a career in nutrition?
Yeah, I think that's a great place to start because maybe not a lot of people know about this career, or at least I didn't know when I was growing up and when I was in high school and it came time to apply to college. I think the biggest motivator for me was when I was in high school, I was 14 years old and my mom was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. So that was a very, very big shift for my family and I mean, it just came out of nowhere. My mom, I would say we grew up fairly healthy. My mom was a stay-at-home mom, cooked a lot at home. She led an active lifestyle. To see her go through this diagnosis, I was so young. I feel like my parents maybe didn't share too many details, but looking back, and I've wanted to like learn more about her health and what that was like, because going through it all, I physically saw her going through the weight changes after getting chemo and radiation. And so that was a scary time. My mom, who was very involved in our lives, all of a sudden was bedridden and bed rest. And so to see her health decline like that was a big shocker. Mm. And I guess I've always also taken an interest in health. I grew up playing sports, and as the oldest of two other siblings, I sort of stepped up to the plate and helped my dad and helped other family members with the area of cooking. I just got very interested in that. And I would call my grandma like, hey, how do I make this soup? And so when it came time to apply to colleges, my dad was the one who guided me and said, hey, look, there's a career as a dietitian. And the running joke was, hey, you could be a dietitian for the San Francisco Giants. So growing up in Northern California, that was like, oh my God, that'd be amazing. So, I'm not, I never tapped into sports dietitian. And my husband is a huge Dodgers fan. So that would have not turned out funny. Well.
That's yeah. Hilarious. Well, that's so interesting that you had such an impactful like collision with health that informed that choice. And I think for a lot of people and people listening to this, that we do sort of have to like meet kind of like that rock in a hard place moment, even if it's not us personally, but like someone really close to us, to sometimes really appreciate the impetus to like, oh, this is something I have control over. This is something that mm-hmm. has a major impact. I mean, it does sometimes take, that type of insight or experience to really begin to take our health and wellness and how we can address it really seriously. And the fact that you met that at 14 is really remarkable. And so tell me a little bit, like, as you stepped into the world of dietetics, like, what are some of the things that you have loved and maybe some of the things that have not landed so well in that space?
Yeah, that's such a great question because I think that almost is like a segue into why my practice is sort of centered around non-dieting and just a different approach than maybe other patients might think, you know, you go to a dietitian, oh, to help me lose weight. Oh, they're going to put me on a diet. So I think for me, like you were saying, like seeing someone's health hit rock bottom, seeing the weight fluctuation, or even just the importance of Western medicine, but also nutrition coming to play and making sure you're getting adequate food intake and all of that. I think I started to view food from a different point of view. And I think it also in part goes to show about like my mom never really dieted. And so I think that's the sort of environment that I grew up in. So when I stepped into the dietetics world, like for me, it was very natural to in a way like talk about what can you do at home, you know, like that doesn't involve drastically cutting calories or eating a bunch of diet food. You know, to me, it was like, well, and now kind of what I talk to my patients about, you know, thinking about like what you, if you're able to take those steps into cooking a little bit more at home or, you know, staying maybe away from processed foods, if that's possible. So that was, stepping into the role as a dietitian, I think that I've enjoyed those conversations with patients where we can really look at the big picture of achieving health in a way that doesn't feel limiting or restrictive. And then I would say, so you were asking about what have I maybe not enjoyed about the career? Yeah, it's tough because I think in different settings that I've worked in, I've worked at a pediatric clinic, and maybe the appointments were centered more around like having my own agenda as a dietitian, you know, like, okay, today we're going to be talking about healthy fats or today we're going to be talking about sugars and things like that. And so I think a lot of times it felt like I was still relaying some of those diet messages. And that was actually my first job as a dietitian. And so I was still trying to figure out like what my niche was, or maybe like what my philosophy was as a new dietitian. So I think those conversations have sparked my love for using the non-diet approach. Yeah. And I also to other jobs that I've had, because after that I worked for a big healthcare company, and we were, you know, they want to see metrics. They want to see that their patients are improving. And so having to always check patients' weight started to be uncomfortable for me, because patients would make comments, negative comments about themselves. Like, oh, I knew my weight was going to go up. Oh my gosh, I just know that I ate so much this weekend. I really need to cut back on my portions. And so in my appointments, when I had to do that, it just created this tension between approaching food from a non-diet perspective. So those have been the not so fun parts about the career, having to weigh patients and then just seeing their disappointment.
Yeah. Well, and it's so interesting. I want to circle back to the pediatric piece, because I think it's really interesting how that setting can be really formative on a nutrition practice. Mm-hmm. But that whole piece of like, what are we really measuring? Like if the endpoint is just that we want a number on the scale, why do we give a frick about what that number says? Like, it's just like one metric, and it's, it's kind of like a double-edged sword, right? Cause you can see that if somebody has a lot of weight to lose because they would feel better mentally and physically and be more capable and have more energy, like you can see the benefits of that. And yet we don't measure any of the other things that we're actually seeking from that change. We just focus on that one pinpoint, which I do think, I mean, that, you know, that experience around just sort of that hyper focus on that one thing, it loses a lot in translation for sure. Mm-hmm. The question I want to ask you about being in the pediatric space is, how did that, I also worked in pediatrics for a time, and it really shifted my philosophy on nutrition. And there was something about like that it wasn't just for now. It wasn't just to address a one specific health concern, that it had something so much longer of a lens to it that really started to shift my experience. Was there anything in being in that like younger family kid space that informed your practice?
Yeah, in a way, I think that brought up a lot of maybe flashbacks to my childhood. And I never even put that together, like studying nutrition and things like that. I mean, I never reflected on my childhood and how that impacted my view on nutrition. So, I mean, just to touch on like growing up, I guess I could say, in a Mexican household or Mexican family, I feel like talking about bodies, whether they're skinny, whether they're larger, or average or curvy or whatever, like we talk a lot about bodies in the Latino family. So, being in the room with these children, I started to pick up on some comments that parents were making. You know, they would say, and I worked with a low-income population in Southern California, in the LA area. So a lot of Spanish-speaking families. And I understand my patients because I grew up in this culture. I am Mexican. And so I would hear parents say, oh, my son, he doesn't eat anything. Like, look at him. He's just so skinny. But my daughter over here, like, oh, I have to almost put a lock on our cabinet because she just sneaks around and just... Look, she's a big girl. And so growing up, I mean, thankfully, thank God, I never had comments from adults, from my parents about my body shape. But I did hear like my sister's nickname. She was a very thin, slender girl. My sister and I are a year and a half apart. And my grandpa would always call her Flaca, which is a nickname for like thin or skinny, you know?
Okay.
And so there was a shift where like, then I got into puberty, my body changed, right? And so all these thoughts about like my body and being self-conscious started to come in. And I just remember thinking like, why is my sister's nickname Blackout? Am I not skinny? And then also I saw some of my aunts go through dieting and then talk about their body in a negative way. So when I was in the pediatric space, I started to have these memories and just, I sort of started piecing things together and I realized, wow, like it really makes a big difference the way that adults talk about their body, talk about food and nutrition. And I just, my heart fell for those kids, for both of them, you know? And I just thought like, of course there's this division of behaviors around the home because one child is being praised for their body being thin and but then at the same time, they're like chasing their child around to eat something because they're afraid that they're going to be not getting the nutrients that they need. And then the other child in the family, like, oh, you're too big. You need to go work out and things like that. So yeah, I just felt a lot of compassion for these families.
Yeah.
These kids.
And it's an important point too, that it always struck me that there wasn't necessarily any ill intent of any parent, right, in the space. Mm-hmm. And it just reflects how deeply conditioned these types of behaviors, the way we use language around bodies and food, it's subconscious to the point that we don't hear it until we actually are aiming to hear it, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's a really interesting perspective that like being in the space and, you know, seeing these kids kind of brought up these memories that you had. And we all would have those memories, right? Like it would have different words. It might have different body types that are praised or appreciated, but there's still a bunch of language and preferences and what we want and don't want all communicated pretty regularly. And if you're not getting it just from language in the family, you're getting it from friends or from media or other sources as well. How would you say that, because you're a mom now, how would you say as you are walking into parenthood, like what are some of the things you think more about now, just as a mom who also has this, you know, superpower of being a dietitian?
Yeah, I think it resonates with me a lot, or even more so. I think my values around using positive language around food and body, or even just a neutral type of language around food and body, is what's showing up more for me. My son is only 8 months, and so when we started with solids, he's been eating solids for a few months now. But I think I just keep thinking about envisioning how he's going to grow up, and I really want him to have that safe space, a positive environment, because although we think more about like maybe women or girls getting criticized about their body, I mean, it can happen to boys too. And so I want him to know that, you know, the food that we're eating at home is going to be giving us nutrition, but it's also playful and fun. And so my hope is that he appreciates food and just has a great love for cooking. If that's something that that he wants to explore, I mean, that'd be amazing. But I want him to be involved with the kitchen, or even setting the table and things like that, and for that to be the connection for our family. So what I'm doing right now with him is just solid foods, but I think I'm doing my best to just create a positive environment. We'll play music and we'll be, you know, away from the TV or tablets, and I do my best to put my phone away and just really be in the moment with him. And that's tough, I would say.
Yeah. I mean, even just that alone, I think a lot of listeners would be like, wow, like I could really have a different experience than I'm maybe currently having. Mm-hmm. I remember when I worked in pediatrics, there was a sweet family. They had two kiddos with cystic fibrosis, which is a full-time job really as a mom of two kids with CF. And I remember her saying that like when she would sit down the kids to eat, she would like get up and go do stuff because it was, you know, she was so stressed for time, right? Between all the treatments and just real life and all these things. And I mean, it's been years since I've worked in that setting, and it's really remarkable how that has stuck with me, because I remember thinking like, oh my gosh, if every time my kids sit down to eat, that's my time to like scramble away. What's our message? What's our connection? Mm-hmm. Like it's, and I mean, we're all doing the best with the cards that we have, and I totally understand that. But I do think, you know, even just what you're saying about being consciously aware of choosing what that environment gets to look like and having it be a place where you can bond and connect. Yeah. I mean, we eat all the time, you know, many times a day, like, you know, even if that one spot in your house is just like a happy, connected few minutes. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a lot. That gives a family a lot.
Yeah. So I love that you bring that up, because I think lately I've been feeling so much pressure to get things done around the house, or even just with my private practice, like, oh, maybe I'll just send a quick email. And so I feel like one of maybe the motivators, aside from creating like a good environment for my son, is for like just being very attentive to him, is just making sure he's not choking or gagging or anything. So that's why I've been extra careful about that. But I guess now he's 8 months, and so I'm feeling more confident with his swallowing and all that. But it's so true. A lot of times I'm tempted, like, oh, he's in his high chair, he's strapped, oh, maybe I'll just put the dishes away and things like that. And I caught myself the other day, and I realized I've had such a hectic day today. This might be my only time to sit down and eat a snack and enjoy it. Mm. So I realized the kitchen will be what it will be. I'm going to sit down and eat a snack with him.
Yeah. Yeah. And those little moments, it's like they add up, you know, over time for sure.
I'm excited that this podcast is brought to you by mkforhealth.com. Have you been looking for a powerful antioxidant to help support your immune health? Hello, of course we have. Look no further. MKForHealth.com offers an amazing product called Nutrimetrics OPC3. This product is an isotonic capable food supplement chock full of powerhouse antioxidants. Ingredients like citrus extract bioflavonoids, bilberry, grapeseed, red wine, and pine bark extracts, all incredible antioxidants. Then you have the OPCs, the oligomeric proanthocyanidins, are bioflavonoids found in fruits, vegetables, and certain tree barks that have exceptional benefit to the human body. Studies have shown that these OPCs are up to 20 times more powerful than vitamin C and 50 times more powerful than vitamin E in neutralizing free radicals. Hello, sign me up for that. Nutrimetrics OPC3 also contains the only isotonic form of pycnogenol in the world. Number one, remember, isotonic, readily absorbed. Number two, pycnogenol, my new favorite word, is a natural plant extract from the bark of a French maritime pine tree, and it is the most clinically researched and potent bioflavonoid found. If you're ready to support your immune health and modulate inflammation in your system, all with incredible powerhouse antioxidants, natural extracts and ingredients, whew, this is your product. Go to www.mkforhealth.com to purchase your Nutrimetrics OPC3 today. That's www.mk4health.com.
I'm so interested to know more about your philosophy and how you support clients, because I think your, you know, focus on non-dieting, first of all, to me, that sounds like freedom, because I don't have a lot of personal experience with trying any particular type of diet, but my experience in working with other people is that it feels like so constrained, right? And yes. Even just the words, like a non-dieting approach, like, oh, it just feels like a release of freedom, a possibility of what gets to be instead of like what has to be. So tell me more about, you know, what shape that takes, like how do you approach something like that? How do clients start to embrace that as a mindset? Because I have to imagine that that's a huge mindset shift. So walk us through that a little bit.
Yeah, I almost would say that non-diet approach almost sort of naturally has led into this mindset of integrative nutrition or integrative care. Because when we let go of, or when me as the dietitian, the healthcare provider, when we let go of putting our patients on diets or telling them this is a list of what you can and cannot eat, I think that opens up the doors for really getting down to the root cause of why they're feeling so stressed. Like why is eating a meal or snacks or breakfast a challenge for you? And so I think it allows more conversations and for me to really help and guide through making these nutrition recommendations actually applicable, or like viewing what's going on in your routine. And I always like to start out that way, like walk me through your day and tell me what is going on, because, you know, someone may be feeling, and I've had this before, patients tell me after working with me, like, wow, thank you so much for creating this, this safe space for me to share what's going on with my health, because I don't feel judged by you. And of course, you know, we hear these messages about nutrition, eat breakfast, drink 8 cups of water and this and that. And they feel so much shame when they tell me, I don't eat breakfast. I know it's so bad. And so I like to tell them, that's okay. You know, we'll work around that. If that's important to you, if you see value in starting to make changes there, we'll figure out something that works best. So that's why I feel that the non-diet approach is so vital, and it's successful. I recently had a patient who had a lot of stress around the need for dieting, especially she was getting mixed messages from her cardiologist. And I'm sure this cardiologist like meant well, like wanted the patient to, you know, improve her blood pressure and cholesterol and all that. So every year he would like flip-flop, like, why don't you try low carb? Why don't you try low calorie? Why don't you try low fat? So she just came to me feeling very confused. And unfortunately it happens, but she ended up developing diabetes. And so we reconnected again. And so I think it's possible to guide your patients through these nutrition recommendations, but also taking that pressure off of feeling like you need to be so restrictive. And she, in a matter of 6 months, has gotten some really great blood results. And so she told me, I just cannot believe that I was able to achieve this without weight loss being the main principle for our session. So she was so thankful for that.
Yeah. And I mean, I just love that so much because it sounds so empowering to the person, right? Like that they get to be part of their health experience. And right, like when I wake
Who
up
would
in the
have thought?
day, yeah, when I wake up and go for a workout, I'm not thinking about doing that to go please someone else, right? Like I'm thinking about doing that so that I can show up as my best for the people that I care about being in relationship with. So, I mean, that mindset shift of like, what is important to me? What does work in my life? I mean, it's a big and important shift. One thing that I always think about around, like, as you're even saying, as a person sharing what their day, the habits and behaviors that they have around food. I think it's kind of a light bulb moment for a lot of people to realize that they're basically like in a relationship with food, and that there's this like kind of mindset and thought process and routine around the interaction with food. What comes up for people in that space? Because I think that's a real, like, I think people kind of feel stuck to their habits often and feel like they're really hard to shift. But that when they learn that food is like serving a certain purpose and often something that's past just like fueling my body, what kind of stuff do you see unfold as they either connect that empowerment to like, oh, I can make a shift in this habit space or in that like food relationship space?
I think that there's, I mean, so many different types of approaches, I guess you can say, that patients take, or when they first come to me, like what their lifestyles look like. I think there's some patients who are constantly feeling like they need to eat and eat and eat because there's some maybe stress behind what's going on. And then maybe there's some other patients who feel like they don't realize that they're not eating enough, or maybe like skipping out on moments to eat. So I think food can be sometimes gets viewed as, I think in general, food gets viewed as time consuming. Like, oh my gosh, like cooking something feels so time consuming, or eating something at work. I'll just grab something at work. And that's fine too. I think like making the best use of your time. But I feel like what comes up often is I think missing out on some of the consistency that we're looking for with food. And in those situations, that's why I like talking about routines, because like what can you sort of, I guess, associate so that you're thinking about food being nurturing rather than food being something that's negative, or that, oh, if I eat this, it's going to make me gain weight. Sometimes too, depending on the patient, but if we're in a office type setting, there's usually coffee available. I think a lot of my patients are very quick to say, oh, I'm so tired, I'm feeling so sluggish, let me grab another cup of coffee, rather than thinking through like, well, when was the last time I had something to eat? And how much water have I had? So I think that food in general tends to be, it seems like there's a lot of confusion and stress around food because of a lot of the diet messages that we're receiving. Don't eat too much, eat less, or maybe even eat some of these superfoods. And maybe that's where some of those patients may feel like, well, I'm eating salads every time, or I'm drinking a smoothie in the morning, or like constantly thinking about food and what their next meal might be. And I think a lot of times they might be, well, maybe what you're eating is so low in calories, or that it's not sustaining you, or maybe not meeting your satisfaction needs. Are you on autopilot when you're eating your chia seed pudding? Like, it does that even taste good to you? And maybe something exploring with a different breakfast option might be an option and the answer to that.
I mean, I just love so much of that, right? Because it's definitely not a one size fits all kind of approach, right? And I think, I mean, even if you're, let's say, doing like a paleo diet, still very one size. Like it has this very specific parameter. And if you became very skilled with it, would you be able to navigate nuances or like this particular food fits in here still? For sure you would. But as a general rule of thumb, that's not the dieting experience, right? Like it just doesn't feel that way. And I mean, even like my husband's been on a years-long journey of trying to figure out like GI health challenges. And it's like there is no one-stop shop for what any one person needs. So why not get serious about like this is what I think I'm quote unquote supposed to do. This is what my life is actually like. Like how do I start to, connect the dots there? And that I hear that in that experience that you're sharing, that people can kind of start to find like, okay, yeah, well, I was supposed to do this, but ooh, this one tweak changes that experience. When your clients start to make those shifts and have some different experiences around food, what else do you notice change in them?
I think their perspective about health and also, I think it also serves as a motivator for them. I think they finally sort of feel relief in that they can enjoy foods that were once off the table, or they can enjoy foods that are part of their culture. I think that's so important. And to keep those family recipes going from one generation to the next. So I think that's the beautiful thing about it. I think patients start to feel like they are taking ownership of their health, like they are the ones in charge, and that's what we want. That's what I want for them. I want them to feel like they can succeed and that there's less stress around food. Because even cooking itself can be stressful if you don't have maybe if you don't plan ahead and but then adding in that piece of like, well, is this good for me or is this bad? Like that's another layer of stress like someone has to mitigate.
So Karina, what other, you've mentioned stress around like time, around food choices. What other stress-oriented, I mean, my experience is that we're like all way overstressed about life, work, kids, like you name it, the list is super long. What role do you see that play in general, just like stress as a broad category in the people that you work with?
Yeah, I think it gets in the way of feeling well. I mean, I think that maybe this addresses mental health and feeling like there's a lot of pressure to do things with your family or maybe like time, not necessarily for not having enough time to eat, but I think the stress of just so such a busy life that we lead, just the hustle of one thing to the next, and always maybe being sort of maybe not having enough time for what our self-care needs look like, and I think this I this this not idea of self care, but because it is super beneficial, but sometimes it's beginning to get misconstrued as feeling like I need to go to the spa or I need to get my nails done, that like money is involved. But I think self-care can just be as simple as I'm gonna go to bed 1 hour earlier, or I'm gonna just take 15 minutes for myself and sit in silence, or maybe go outside and get some fresh air. So I think maybe not having enough time for self-care is what shows up for my patients a lot. And sometimes the conversation then leads to, and that's a great segue for like talking about exercising and how that can really help reduce some of those stressors, the anxiety, the tension, maybe emotions of anger or always being upset or not in a happy place. And that's, I think, something that falls into the integrative piece that I was talking about earlier. You know, like what type of support do you have at home? Any friends, your spouse? Do you feel like you can connect with someone on that level? And when that is a big challenge for my patients, I think food ends up being even harder, or like changes to their nutrition feels even harder to achieve. And I've had those conversations with patients, and I've told them, you know, maybe it's not time for us, for you to focus on eating snacks. You know, maybe the conversation is around, how can you get more sleep? How can you feel more energized? And that might start with, like I said, asking for help from your spouse or going to bed early. And a lot of times too, I always recommend maybe working with a therapist as a way to have another outlet and someone else to speak with. And I saw a lot of that when I used to work for a big healthcare company, Cigna, and I was a health coach for an employee wellness program. And my colleagues were dietitians, but also nurses and also mental health therapists. So it felt very natural for me to suggest, hey, why don't you work with my colleague? She's a really great counselor. And that having someone to speak with about stress, grief, or just, you know, not meeting your needs for self-care is going to be an important piece to taking care of your nutrition. And yeah. And since I left that job, I mean, I think that I've been, that stuck with me, and I see mental health and therapists a really integrative part of someone's care team.
Yeah. I think that integration piece is so important, and I'm so glad that you brought that up, because in a lot of self-care, we will single out the body as if it's like this thing that's unto itself. And it just simply doesn't work that way. And yeah. So it gets really challenging, right, to address like a physical need. And I understand that it lands in this physical basket, mm-hmm. but it's just, we're missing the boat if we aren't willing to say, like, what are the other parts of me that show up as an expression in my physical body, right? Like, what things do I have undealt with? What lack of support or relationships do mm-hmm. I have? Like, what are the other things that come up as part of, like, I mean, I always think about, like, if somebody's on a weight loss journey, I mean, one of my first questions that goes through my head is, like, what is it that you are ready to let go of? Mm-hmm. Right? Because, like, there's something holding on. Like, yeah. Your physical body is holding on. What, maybe not physically, but in a different area, might you be ready to, like, release and let go of and start to, quote unquote, shed? And so that integrative piece of, like, we are a whole, and we can't only think of ourselves as, like, oh, well, I'm taking care of my body. No, yeah. It just yeah, doesn't
no,
work that
not
way.
Possible. No, yeah. Right.
Yeah. And so what are there, like, practices that you see people really successful with, or is it going to a therapist, or, like, what other avenues end up becoming really important to that, like, total package?
I think care from maybe a primary care doctor. I like discussing that with my patients too, especially for those who feel maybe like they are constantly getting negative comments from their doctor about losing weight and that pressure of losing weight. I like to encourage them, and I tell my patients, you know, you have the option to seek care somewhere else. I encourage you to find a healthcare provider, a PCP, primary care doctor, who supports your beliefs around eating well and not having to worry about the scale, or even someone who hears your need for, my goal is to one day not be on so many pills, so much medication. You know, I think it's important to feel comforted and heard from your doctor as well. And I think that I think for me, it's so important because my aunt is a doctor. She's in, what is she specialized in? Integrative medicine. Mm-hmm. So she also has this great philosophy. And I've learned so much from her about like the holistic approach and how herbs and supplements or medicine can really come together. And she values nutrition. And I think we always have great conversations. So I just know how compassionate she is with her patients. And that inspires me to have those conversations with my patients. You know, you need to feel supported by your doctor, because then I've also had patients who kind of, how would I explain it? Sort of like don't see the need for taking their medication. And that can be very scary too, because Western medicine has advanced so much, and it's important to take blood pressure pills or whatever you're prescribed, but there's also this avenue that you can explore with lifestyle changes as well. So aside from mental health, I always encourage my patients to talk about what their values are for health with their primary care doctor, someone mm-hmm. who they feel heard, and exercise tends to be another piece as well. Doing something that feels good, or maybe just thinking outside the box and not feeling like you have to subscribe to a gym membership to take care of your body in that way. Those are some of the pillars that I like to talk about in my session.
Yeah. And you already mentioned sleep, which is like,
yes, and sleep. Yeah.
A holy grail as well.
Definitely. Yeah.
I love that. What would you say are some of like the more exciting shifts that you see in your clients, like after they've worked with you and have maybe, you know, made a change or have some new habits? Like, what's the main thing you notice in them as that journey really progresses?
I think what I notice is they start to think about food differently. And one patient told me, I started to think about food as like fueling my tank. So I love the way that he said that, because he just started to think about his fatigue and how that was cured essentially by eating food. You know, it's like, man, who would have thought like eating something and cutting back on the caffeine is what helped him reach his goals. So I love when I have that light bulb moment and no longer fear food. You know, I think that with dieting, there is this idea of being afraid of carbs or being afraid of fat, or even just being afraid of being hungry, but seeing that as a bad thing. And so in our conversations, I feel like it's so important to address that, you know, it's okay if you're hungry, and that is your body's sign. And maybe we need some reflection on, you know, I just ate 1 hour ago. Oh my gosh, how can I be hungry? So then we reflect on, well, was that enough food for you? Did you maybe need another portion? And it feels sort of like you're stepping out of the norm with serving yourself seconds, because well, maybe we're instructed by the diet industry to cut back on portions, cut back on this or that. And so serving and filling up your plate feels uncomfortable or feels like it's not normal when you see other friends, maybe coworkers who are eating in a different way. It's almost like they are challenging the status quo. And I like when they have that light bulb moment and start to appreciate food from a different way and really just enjoy the flavor of food. And my gosh, I was so surprised by that. I had one patient when I worked with her for several sessions. This was at the employee wellness program. What I love is that it was free for these clients. So it was, I really got to connect with them. I think I saw them like for 30 visits. So I got to really establish that rapport. And at one of the sessions, I told her, hey, I'd like for you to write down a list of all the diets that you've ever been on. And we also reflected on, well, when was the first time that you dieted? When was the first time that you started to feel uncomfortable with your body, having negative thoughts about your body shape? And she was a 40-year-old woman. And I think she said she started dieting at age 17. So this list, I mean, gosh, I asked her to read it out loud. I just felt like that was powerful. And she couldn't even finish through because she was just like, wow, wow. I've been wasting years and years of trying to search for the perfect thing, and nothing is getting me there. So when she had that realization of, you know, maybe I can enjoy this holiday meal with my family without having to cook something else for myself that fits into the parameters of my diet, I think that brought a really great perspective for her, and that sense of freedom. Mm-hmm. I think we were talking before we started recording, but it's like alleviating, like, oh my God, I don't have to follow a diet. Like, wow. Okay.
Yeah. I know at our house, I always say, like, when the kids say something about, oh, that's weird, I'm like, weird is good. Like, let's get as weird as we possibly can, because for the vast majority of us, like, normal. And if in this context, normal is like constant dieting and trying trend diets and all those things, if that's normal, then let's get super weird and out of that pattern, because then there's something available to us, something that's true and something that's connected to who we are as a human and what we want. Yeah, be the weird one at work. Why not? I'd much rather be the weird one than the normal one, you know, never touching a carb again or whatever, whatever the new normal might be. Yeah, I love that.
I also noticed a lot of growth in my patients. I just thought about that one patient who I shared with you, who was getting all these mixed messages from her cardiologist, and she started to not let weight loss be the center of her behavior change. We had a follow-up session, and I was so proud because she told me, I started telling my coworkers, you know, I don't want to hear that talk. If you don't mind, can we just not talk about how bad we're being by eating these cupcakes, or how bad we're being by going to get takeout? And so I think these conversations also empower my patients to tell others around them, you know, what's the big deal? I'm eating a bagel. Like, can you just let me enjoy it, please? Mm-hmm. So that's what's so special about these conversations with my patients. I love hearing that from them.
Yeah, no kidding. And then it's like a ripple effect, right? Because then it's like, oh, it sparks another person's idea that maybe there's something different available to them too.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Karina, I mean, we could really go on because I could talk about this for a very, very long time. And I just love, you know, the perspective that you have and sort of the path that led you to that place. I think it's just full of, I guess the word that comes to mind is intention. Like, you got there on purpose, not just because you decided, like, I'm a non-dieting, you know, dietitian, there are certainly those people out there. So I love that you came to this, like, from such an integrated viewpoint and empowering viewpoint. I think that's really powerful. For people to find out more about you, where can they go? Where should they head?
Yeah, you check out my website, karinanutrition.com. I'm taking patients virtually. That's what's so great about the pandemic. I think that telehealth has become a really great platform for that. Yeah. So check out my services, and I do take insurance with most PPO company insurances. So you can find more about pricing and how I work one-on-one with patients. Also follow me on Instagram at karina.nutrition. I like sharing tips about non-diet approach, but also recipes here and there. And then you can also reach me by email, karina@karinanutrition.com.
Awesome. Well, we'll make sure we share all those places for people to find you in our show notes and whatnot. But I just thank you for this conversation and the way that you're showing up in the world to help support people grow and find health in a way that matters to them, and not just to check a box on some form that, you know, says a particular thing. So keep up the good work. And I will make sure we include all the things. I know you're going to spark some ideas for some people listening for sure. So All right.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks for inviting me, Cole. This was so great to talk to you about nutrition.
Yeah, I loved it. I appreciate it. And thank you to everyone listening for your time. I do not take that lightly at all. I know we're all strapped for time. So thanks for spending some of it with us here today. And we will catch you next time.